Hello, my name is Keith Mosher. I'm one of the instructors at the Memphis School of Preaching, and it's my privilege today to begin a study with you of the book of Romans. It's my contention that this book is one of the most misunderstood letters in all of the New Testament. Most people approach it as if it were a personal letter, and certainly there are some personal things that Paul says to the Romans, but generally speaking, concisely speaking, this is a treatise on justification. The word translated justification in the text is a word often translated righteousness. In fact, that's the way the King James translators translate it in the book of Romans. But we're looking at justification and the reasons that only in the gospel can a person be justified. That's the essence of this text. It's not understood by many who teach it. And it is the case that if we will start in Romans 15:24 today, we'll get a proper approach to the study of Romans. Here we're told by the Apostle Paul that he intended to go to Rome when he took his journey into Spain. He will go to Rome, but not the way he intended. Paul will go there as a prisoner of the Roman Empire. But here he said, I will come to you when I go on my way to Spain. Possible reasons then for writing to them are twofold. He probably wanted to establish a base in Rome where those brethren could help him on his way to the country of Spain. And also, since he'd never been to Rome, he wanted to establish a sense of fellowship with these people. But he had something with him that he had to take to Jerusalem first. And that was a contribution from many of the Gentile churches to the saints and others in Jerusalem who were in need of this kind of help. And a lot of them had stayed over after Pentecost. They had no way to support themselves. And you remember that Paul told the Corinthian brethren, for instance, to take up a collection for these saints, as the churches of Galatia had, and as the churches of Macedonia had, 1 Corinthians 16, 1 and 2, and also 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. But this contribution helps us understand what was on his mind when it came to writing this letter, because Paul knew that if he went down to Jerusalem with a contribution from the Gentiles, it was possible that the Jews would not accept it, being from those that they call dogs on occasion. If you look at verse 31 with me of Romans 15, you'll notice that Paul asked the brethren in Rome to pray for him, verse 30, that I may be delivered from them that do not believe in Judea, and that my service which I have for Jerusalem may be accepted of the saints. The Jewish-Gentile relationship is at the core of the letter to the Romans. And he will have to explain both to the Gentiles and the Jews why both of their systems were no longer in effect, why neither one of those systems had ever produced justification. And in doing that, this treatise on how a man is justified will become the very core, the very essence of the letter to the Roman brethren. What's behind the teaching in Romans is not about the law of Moses so much, but about the Abrahamic promise. And that Abrahamic promise is out of obedient faith, not out of the law of Moses. And that's going to take some time for Paul to explain that to these Jewish brethren. But we learn from Romans 15 a proper approach to this letter that has to do with the Jewish-Gentile prejudice. When you study this letter, I want you to understand that Paul parallels his thoughts when he writes it. First, we need to learn that from verse 18 through chapter 5, verse 11, that's 1:18 through 5:11, and then from 5:12 to 8:39, we have parallel thoughts. Both sections are actually discussing how sin entered the world and that the only remedy to that is in Christ. That's 1:18 through 5:11, and then starting in 5:12 through 8:39, the end of that chapter, we have the idea that sin entered the world, and the only remedy is not the old patriarchal system, not the Jewish system, but Christ. Then in chapter 3, verse 21 through verse 26, Paul talks about, where is boasting then? Is it excluded? Yes. By what law? The law of faith. And then he parallels that in chapter 6. He tells us Christ sacrificed for us, and then here's how we appreciate it. Then you have in chapter 3, verse 27 through 31, a parallel in Romans 7, 1 through 25 in that chapter. It's the law of the gospel that rules, not the law of Moses, certainly not the patriarchal system. And then in chapter 4, Paul talks about the meaning and power of obedient faith and how Abraham was justified. It's interesting that he parallels that in Romans 8. That same thought. There is a relationship to the promise made to Abraham that is important to all of us. We are not under the law of Moses, we're not under the patriarchal system, but certainly the promise God made to Abraham recorded for us in Genesis 12, verse 3, helps us understand his thesis here on justification. And finally, in chapter 5, verses 1 through 11, there's an exact parallel in Romans 8, beginning at verse 18 through 39, where he tells us obedient faith accesses grace, and that's victory. And so when we look at a proper approach to Romans, there was a Jewish-Gentile problem, and we need to understand that the gospel is neither Gentile nor Jewish. And then he parallels his thoughts to get us to understand sin entered the world. And the only remedy is Christ. Paul's theme in the book of Romans, has to be understood. Paul's theme is justification. That's through the first 11 chapters especially. His thesis, how that's occurring, is in Romans 1, 16 and 17, where the apostle writes, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Now listen to him. For therein, what, Paul? The gospel is revealed, a righteousness of God. God's righteous, and he has the ability to justify. That's revealed only in the gospel, Paul says. As it is written, from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. This new gospel system is not like the patriarchal system. This new gospel system is not like the ancient law of Moses system. It's different. It has the inherent power in it to save everybody from Adam to Keith. It is the power that God uses to justify all men. The purpose of the book then comes out of a statement Job asked years and years and years ago, of course, Job 9:2. Job asked, how can a man be just before God? Paul said in the gospel, Romans 1:16, Job 9:2. The theme of the book, justification from obedient faith. The thesis, it takes the gospel to save everybody. Adam, if he obeyed God, was saved by the blood of Christ. Moses, if he obeyed God, was saved by the blood of Christ. It's the case also that Keith, if he's going to be saved, is saved by the good news that Jesus died for me and there's a way for me to access that system that saves me. We're going to discover that Paul uses some words in this letter differently from the way he uses them in other places. But I'm going to say here as a precursor to other things we'll be studying that every time Paul uses the words faith and law in both Romans and Galatians together, same context, faith and law, he means the gospel system in contrast to the law of Moses. He does not mean faith only in contrast to all law. He means the gospel system in contrast to the law of Moses. In Galatians 3:23, Paul will write, before faith came, we were kept under the law. shut up unto the faith, which afterward should be revealed. Well, let's look at that verse carefully. Before faith came, we were kept under the law. Paul can't mean by the word faith there, my personal faith, because that would have meant that Moses, who lived under the law of Moses, Joshua, who lived under the law of Moses, had no personal faith. But Paul said, before faith came, we were kept under the law. He means before the gospel came. So when we study Romans together, in fact, if we studied it with Galatians, we'd learn that when Paul used the word faith and he put law with it in the same context, he meant the gospel system versus the law of Moses. And so it's the case that we have a proper approach. We understand there was a Jewish-Gentile problem. We have a parallel thought process to look at in this book, and we have the purpose of the book to show that justification only comes to all people in the gospel of Jesus Christ. There was always that case that someone would come along and study the book of Romans and presume that it taught faith only. And that probably may be the biggest problem in the works that men do in studying this letter. One of the most infamous who took a look at Romans and thought, well, we're saved by faith only, was, of course, Martin Luther. On November 3rd in 1515, Luther started to teach the book of Romans at the University of Wittenberg. That's the place where he nailed his theses to the door, you remember. But he started teaching Romans at the University of Wittenberg, and he started on November 2nd of 1915. He didn't finish teaching until September 7th, 1516. That's a long period of time spending on the book of Romans. In fact, he lectured to his students at that university and never took a summer break. And we have a lot of his material then that we can see. In fact, his manuscripts were published in 1909 by a fellow from the Vatican Library named Johannes Ficker. But we have a record of what Luther was teaching. And Luther radically departed from his Roman Catholic background when he started teaching this book. He started to note that the historical context was contrasting some kind of faith and some kind of law, which he misunderstood. He did not realize that Paul was using the word faith to refer to the gospel system. So Luther saw the word faith in the book of James and decided, well, James must be contradicting Paul, Romans, because they both use the same word. What Luther didn't realize was Paul's talking about the gospel system in contrast to the law of Moses, while James was talking about personal faith that without works is dead, being alone, James 2:24. And so it's the case that Luther said the book of James just doesn't need to be in the New Testament. And out of his study of the book of Romans came this doctrine that is so prevalent among so many people, it's just faith only. The moment I have the thought in my head that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, I'm saved. Well, Luther said he got that from the book of Romans. And his notes show us that he thought that this letter was the purest gospel ever written. He kind of follows a man named Marcion, a second century heretic, who would not accept any other epistles except Paul's as far as his Bible was concerned. And he certainly taught faith only. So Luther wasn't the first one to teach faith only, but certainly his teaching has led so many to take that position. Luther thought that once you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, once you did that, then whatever sin you committed after that was forgiven at your death. And as long as you believed, you could commit all kinds of sin, and they would all be removed at your death. And Luther actually said, the trouble with God's law is I can't keep it. You will hear this teacher say a lot about this idea that I can't keep God's law. John told us this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous, 1 John 5:3. And so we're going to insist as we study the book of Romans, we can keep God's law. We can do this. We can live faithfully. There is a way to do that. And the book of Romans should help us be confident in that. In fact, Paul's going to teach us that we need to get out of the sinning business. Romans 6, 1 and 2. But here's Luther now. And if you asked Mr. Luther, what's the only sin that will keep you out of heaven? He said, not believing. Just don't believe and you'll be kept out of heaven. You decide to believe and you're going to heaven no matter what else you do, whatever sin you commit, how evil you become, you're going to heaven. You can commit every sin of the flesh and grace alone will cover it as long as you believe. But if you're an unbeliever, then you can't go to heaven. That is really an extreme position, but it's one that he taught. In this letter, we're going to read about something that the translators called imputed righteousness. Now, we already have said that the theme of the book of Romans is righteousness, or better, justification. That's a legal term. And it's only God who can justify. God must then choose to justify. Does he have any requisites if he's going to justify me? And then we're going to read about a man named Abraham who was reckoned righteous, or it was imputed to him for righteousness' sake. And we're going to have to take a look at this idea of justified, justification. But keep in mind that the word justification is a legal term, and God legally justifies me. And he has his reasons, God does, for doing so. When I think about justification, I have to remember that God is the standard of justification. In fact, the psalmist in the long ago, in writing about this theme of justification, made it very clear that the standard is always God. This is Psalm 50 and verse 6. And the heavens shall declare his righteousness, for God is judge himself. The standard of righteousness is the Almighty God of heaven. He is the Holy One. If you would open to Psalm 111 for a moment. I don't think you can open to Romans 111. But in Psalm 111 at verse 7, he says, the works of his hands are verity, that's truth, and justice. All his commandments are sure. If someone were to ask who is the standard of justification, God is. We're told in the book of Judges 5:11, shall not the judge of all the earth do right? John talks about how righteous God is, John 17:5. The Hebrews writer talks about God being holy and pure and just, Hebrews 12:23. And we're told in our letter that we're studying, Romans 3 and verse 26, that God, by sending his Son, proved that he is righteous. In fact, that sending of his Son was a declaration to the whole world that whatever God did, in whatever way he did it, he was right. And so when I think about justification, my first thought is that God is the standard. My second thought is that if God is the standard of justification, he is that in an absolute sense. And I can make that claim for the second person of the Godhead who came to earth that we call Jesus, that the Bible says he was named because he would save his people from their sins. We're told that when he was on the cross, one said of him, truly, this was a righteous man, Matthew 27, 19 through 24. In the book of Acts, as Luke records the activities of Jesus and then the activities of the apostles, Luke says about Jesus, this is Acts 3 and verse 14, that he is the Holy One and the just, and the people desired a murderer instead. In the absolute sense, then, the second person of the Godhead is righteous, is just, is one who can justify. When Paul stood on the Areopagus, Mars Hill, he said, God has appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man. Here again, a statement, that's Acts 17:31, about the absolute righteousness of God. Paul, as he's thinking about his death, makes mention of the absolute righteousness of the second person of the Godhead, 2 Timothy 4:8. But when I have to think about me, mankind, I do not claim absolute righteousness. I do not claim what he is. Because inherently, in the absolute sense, God, second person, Holy Spirit, who is God, Acts 5, 3 and 4. Absolutely, inherently, that's their essence. But when I think about being righteous for me, before Christ came, all mankind was only declared righteous in a relative sense. Now, we need to read those verses. It's said of Joseph, the stepfather of our master. He's a just man. He's a righteous man. He was not willing to put away Mary. He's a just man, but only in a relative sense. All men come short in that sense, especially before Christ died on the cross. And so God had to declare a man righteous, even though Jesus hadn't died on the cross yet. Let's read Romans 4:3. What saith the scripture? Abraham believed God. Now listen, and it was counted, reckoned, imputed unto him, Abraham, for righteousness. Here's a man who did what was right under the patriarchal system. Here's a man who obeyed God the best way he knew how, according to the law he had. And God said, I'm going to reckon you righteous. Was God righteous in doing that? Open again to Romans, the 3rd chapter. God declared Abraham righteous before God, before Christ ever died on the cross. And we're told here in Romans 3:24 that men today are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Now verse 25, watch. Whom, that's Christ Jesus, God hath put on display, set forth into the world to be a mercy seat, a propitiation. This word's different from that one over there in 1 John 2:2. This is the case that Jesus is said to be the mercy seat. Well, you remember that's where the high priest met God. And how do I meet God today? In Christ. He's the mercy seat, and God put him forth in public to be the mercy seat through faith in his blood to declare the Father's righteousness. Interesting statement. Was the Father righteous in declaring Abraham to be righteous even though Christ hadn't died on the cross? Why, of course. Abraham, I'm going to count you righteous because I, the Father, can look down through history and I can see the cross. And in lieu of the cross, I can declare you righteous. To declare his, the Father's righteousness, for remitting all those sins from past times when the people of past times lived according to the system under which they found themselves. God had a way of declaring them righteous in a relative sense. It's almost as if he put it on their account, which is what the word means. God put it on Abraham's account that Abraham was righteous simply because Abraham obeyed God under that system. This is what Paul meant when he told the people on Mars Hill, the times of this ignorance, not ignorance, times characterized by ignorance of something. God, now the King James has winked at, that is, God overlooked. He looked right over the top of those times characterized by ignorance of something. What was it they didn't know about in that time? Judgment Day, Acts 17:31. It's connected to verse 30, for he hath appointed a day. Why wasn't there a judgment day appointed during the patriarchal system? That's where Abraham lived. Why wasn't there a judgment day appointed during the Mosaic period? That's where Moses lived. Weren't those people going to be judged? Yes, on judgment day. However, there was no judge yet in place. The Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment to the Son, John 5:22. And so God overlooked those times characterized by ignorance of the judgment day, but now commendeth all men everywhere to repent. Why? Because judgment day can happen anytime. Now, Paul says God was righteous in forgiving Abraham in lieu of the coming of the Son. God was righteous for the remission of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God, Romans 3:25. And Paul repeats it for us. What's the theme of the book of Romans? Justification. Well, God justified the faithful under the patriarchal system. God justified the faithful under the Jewish system. Was God righteous in doing that? The gospel screams, yes. 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 Because he knew his Son was coming, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. When I look at the cross, I'm seeing God's justice. I'm seeing that God does right. I'm seeing that God saved folks in lieu of the coming of the cross. If you look at Hebrews 9:15 now, you will see that the Hebrews writer understood what we've been saying for the past few minutes, that God justified those under the Old Testament because God knew he was going to send his Son to accomplish that. In the Hebrews letter, chapter 9, verse 15, that writer says, and for this cause he, Christ, is the mediator of the New Testament. But watch, that by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the First Testament, they which are called might receive the promise, Abrahamic promise was about salvation, of inheritance. And so we're learning that there was a plan set in motion. Peter tells us before the foundation of the world, 1 Peter 3:18 and following. Before the foundation of the world, God had a plan set in motion that whoever sinned had an opportunity to come back to God through his Son. Even though the Son hadn't literally died on the cross yet, God could declare Abraham righteous when Abraham obeyed God, simply because God knew he was going to send his Son, and that Son would die for Abraham too. Now, Abraham was declared righteous in prospect of the coming of the Christ, but Christ has already come. He's already died on that cross. That has already been accomplished. You remember that just before he died, Jesus said, "It is finished." He told his Father in that high priestly prayer recorded for us in the 17th chapter of John, "I have finished the work that thou sent me to do. I'm done, Father. It's over. It's accomplished." Well, all men now can be saved by the blood of Christ. Abraham in prospect of the cross, but what about those who obey him now that's been accomplished? They're not reckoned righteous in lieu of the cross. They are declared righteous because of the cross. We are a people who have been made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. 2 Corinthians 5:21. That took a tremendous gift to give us that. It's not that God says, "Keith, one day you'll be righteous." from the blood of Christ. Keith, you are now declared righteous by the blood of Christ. I am not a perfect individual. That's God's essence. I am not inherently righteous. That's God's essence. I am a person declared righteous because of the blood of Christ. I am justified. The old preachers got a hold of that thought, justified, and they would tell the audience, God looks at me, justified, never sinned. Am I perfect? No, I'm forgiven. Am I holy? Well, God says I'm declared to be that, even though I come up short sometimes. That's what God's grace does for me. When I obey God, God makes up the rest of my imperfections through the blood of His Son. God has then the ability, if we can use that term, to say, Keith, you're not perfect, but you're forgiven. What a wonderful, wonderful, peaceable, worthy thought that is, my friend. To be free from the guilt of sin is no greater way to live. And the book of Romans shows us that God always had that in mind. He could declare Abraham righteous, but He can declare me righteous in the absolute sense because of the blood of Christ. Look back again at Galatians 3 with me and notice something very important here. We're told here in the 23rd chapter that before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith, which should afterward be revealed. I've already commented on that for us, that he's talking about the gospel system in comparison to the law of Moses. He goes on to say, wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified out of faith. Ek pistou, out of faith. Well, he means the gospel system. Why did God justify me? By faith, but not faith alone. Watch him as he writes now. But after that faith, that new system has come, we're no longer under the law of Moses. We talked about the Jewish-Gentile problem, and as we study the letter, we're going to find out the Jews were quite upset that Paul was telling them, your system doesn't exist anymore. And you weren't justified by it anyway, Galatians 2:16. Nobody could be justified by the law of Moses. People kept the law of Moses, and they kept it well. Luke 1:6, Zechariah and Elizabeth walked in all the commandments of the Lord blameless. Philippians 3:8-9, Paul says, as touching the law, blameless. People kept it, but the law could not justify them. And because it could not justify them, God had a plan that would. And when that new plan came, that old system was done away. We're no longer under it. Then he says, for you're all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. When we talk about the word in, we're talking about a location. It is a fact of Greek idioms, and the Greek grammar books will show you this, that you cannot faith into something. What he's talking about is where that gospel system is located. It's in Christ. And that's why we have the next verse, because to get into Christ requires baptism, Galatians 3:27. And I can't get into Christ without it. I have a pond on my property. If I'm standing on the bank of that pond, I cannot grammatically jump in the water. I have to be in the water to jump in it. I can jump into the water from the bank, grammatically speaking. The translators understood that. When this verse says faith in Christ, it's talking about the location of the gospel, where it is. That gospel that can justify me. Well, that tells me that unless I'm in Christ, I'm not justified. And on how do I get into Christ? I'm baptized into Christ. And if I be in Christ, then I'm Abraham's seed and heirs according to that promise that God made to Abraham in the long ago, that in his seed all the nations of the earth would be blessed, Genesis 12:3. When the Bible talks about imputed righteousness, it's talking about a declared state. However, the Roman concept is not imputed righteousness, but infused righteousness. Their concept is, if you do enough works, you earn righteousness. It becomes your reward for your gifts. It's as if you got your ticket punched. The Protestant idea of righteousness is transferred. The moment you think in your head that Jesus is the Christ, His righteousness is transferred to you. And once you have it, you can't lose it. Once you have it, it's yours, and you can't ever be lost. Once you're saved, you're always saved because it's not your righteousness, it's His. This particular idea of transferred righteousness flies in the face of a statement that Peter made. He said, "Of a truth I perceive that in every nation he that does righteousness is accepted of him." Acts 10:34-35. If you'll open your New Testament to that little epistle of 1 John, we'll notice how John speaks of this idea of righteousness. And John says, it's not transferred from Christ to you. It's something that you have to do. This is 1 John 3 and verse 7. And here John writes, "Little children, let no man deceive you." Do folks try to deceive us about righteousness? "Let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous." We have a part in salvation. We have to obey the faith, the gospel system, in order to be saved. And second, John says, 1 John 2:29, the following, "If you know that He is righteous," and we've already shown that God is absolutely righteous, and so is Christ, so is the Holy Spirit. "If you know that He is righteous," watch, "you know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of Him." God reckons me righteous. He doesn't transfer righteousness to me. There's a song that we often sing, "Dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne." Biblically, there's something very wrong with that statement, because we're not dressed in His righteousness alone. You and I have a part in our salvation. When we obey the gospel, God declares us in the absolute sense now, because of the blood of Christ, to be righteous. And when Abraham obeyed God under the patriarchal system, when Moses obeyed God under the law of Moses system, they were declared in prospect of the cross that they would be righteous. I love what Paul tells us about being a Christian, though. In speaking of Jesus and the ministry of reconciliation and how we're all brought to God, Paul said, "God made Him," Christ, "to be sin." That is, the sin offering. Who knew no sin? Paul's very careful to tell us he didn't become a sinner, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Christ. When you hear a gospel preacher tell you, "Get baptized into Christ," he's telling you, that's how you get justified. And it's the power of God, this gospel is, to justification. When I think about the letter to the Romans, its purpose, its a proper approach, its theme and its thesis, its theme, justification, its thesis, only in the gospel. Isn't that unusual that Paul would argue the gospel saved Adam, it saved Moses, it saved Abraham, it will save Keith? That's what he's saying. It's the gospel that did it all. Well, what about Paul? He's our author. He's our writer. Nobody disputes that, of whom I'm aware. But Paul, he's writing in a time of heathenism, decay, much like this country today, which has become as immoral as any country could be. But Paul was writing in a time of polytheism, many, many, many gods around. He was writing in a time of skepticism, superstition, stoicism, Platonic Greek thoughts and so on, Judaism. But God chose a man who was prepared to write a thesis, a treatise, more than just a personal letter, Romans. It's almost as if Paul was asked by God, write a manuscript. Do some research. Well, Paul didn't have to do the research. The Holy Spirit did it for him. But Paul, you studied under Gamaliel. You studied at the University of Tarsus. You're trained in Judaism. You said even better than all your Hebrew brothers. You're trained in Greek philosophy. I want you to write this letter. And I want you to help people understand the power of the gospel of Christ and how it justified and why it had to be the gospel and could not be the patriarchal system, could not be the law of Moses. I heard a preacher say one time, well, God could have saved us any way He wanted to save us. But He decided to send His Son. That would not be correct. That's an unfortunate statement to have someone make. Because the moment that perfect man Adam sinned in the garden, the justice of God came into play. And the justice of God required a perfect sacrifice to take Adam's place. And that perfect sacrifice not only saved Adam when he obeyed God, not only saved Abraham, saved Moses, saved Keith. In this letter, as we study it, we'll take a look from time to time at some of the errors that have been taught from it. I've already mentioned one to you perpetrated by Martin Luther, in which he came to the idea it's faith alone, not realizing that Paul was using the word faith as a synonym for the whole gospel system. And it's also the case that a doctrine called premillennialism, especially when we get to Romans 11, a lot of folks teach premillennialism from the book of Romans. And the idea that all of the Jews must one day be saved and gathered in Jerusalem and so on. There was a church in Rome, and so let's look at some preliminary thoughts about it. Although, again, let me insist, this is not really a personal letter, but a treatise on justification. Although some personal things are said, especially chapter 1 and chapter 16. But let me think about this. I don't have a Bible passage that tells me how this church got started. One writer in the 4th century said that the church in Rome started without ever having seen an apostle in Rome. Well, Paul had never been there, Romans 1:11. He said, I want to come and establish you. I want to give you the miraculous gifts you don't really have yet. But nobody really knows how this congregation got started. We do know that on the day of Pentecost, Acts 2:10, there were strangers and proselytes from Rome there, and maybe they heard the gospel and took it back with them. And some of them came back there with a miraculous gift of prophecy, Romans 12, beginning at verse 5. Or maybe those that were scattered abroad out of Jerusalem, Acts 8:4, started this congregation. Or it could be it was just ordinary travel. These folks were going back home. But we really don't have a verse that tells us exactly how this church got started. We know that Peter didn't start it. There are 27 names mentioned in this letter as being members in the church at Rome, Romans chapter 16. Peter is not mentioned there one time. You'd think that if he were prominent in the church there in Rome, that Paul would have mentioned his name. He does not. The Roman church likes to use Acts 12:17 to insist that that's about Peter and that he went to Rome. But all that verse says is Peter went to another place. That teaching is based on a misunderstanding. Their argument is that Peter went to Rome to challenge Simon Magus because a man named Justin Martyr saw a statue there that said Decimo Sanctus. Well, Decimo Sanctus and Simon Magus are different individuals. Decimo Sanctus was nothing more than a Roman god. But again, Ambrosiaster, AD 200, Hilary in AD 300, all said that the Romans believed without ever seeing an apostle or a miracle. I do know that Peter was in Jerusalem in AD 51, Acts 15. Peter was in Antioch in AD 54, Galatians 2:1. And all of the apostles were in Jerusalem in Acts, according to Acts 8:1 in AD 42 to 48. And I also know that Peter could not have been the first pope. He was married, Matthew 8:14 and 15. At least the Bible says he had a mother-in-law. And that would mean that he was married. We're told in Galatians 2 that he was not infallible. Paul had to withstand him to his face because he was to be blamed. He made a mistake. He also was a fellow elder, 1 Peter 5, 1 and 2. And he told those elders, don't lord it over God's heritage. And so, who started the church in Rome? The Bible doesn't tell us. We know Peter wasn't there. We know Paul wasn't there. And so, but we have a church here that was able to hear Paul's discussion of justification. And it's interesting to me, and I don't know why, that God chose this particular church to write such a treatise, but he did. And you know that when Paul got there and God started going up the Appian Way and started walking and those brethren came to meet him, that they never said to him, who wrote that letter we got? They knew that the Apostle Paul had written it. And he wrote it probably from Corinth, maybe from Ephesus, before he ever got to Rome. It's interesting to note that the gospel spread so quickly in the Roman Empire. Paul told us, Colossians 1:23, that wherever he went, the gospel was preached to everybody under heaven. He had free reign to do that. And there are some reasons why that's the case, and I want to mention them here. Rome was at peace. The Pax Romana was a wonderful thing. People could go to a city and meet people from all over the world. The cities were cosmopolitan. Taking the gospel into one of those cities could perhaps spread it to the whole world. And so here is Rome at peace. In fact, Rome had stopped even the piracy on the Mediterranean in its time. There was peace. There was an ability to go into a city and just meet somebody from all over the world. And I remember one time being in Botswana, Africa, and I offered the invitation, and a Caucasian individual came forward to be baptized, unusual in Africa, and come to find out he was from Kansas. I was halfway around the world, so was he, and he came forward to be baptized. He was in the Peace Corps over there, and I thought unusual that a man from Mississippi meets a man from Kansas over in Botswana, Africa. Well, to go in one of these Roman cities, it's the case that you could meet someone from all over the world. Not only that, Rome at this time was very eclectic in its thinking. They did not avoid new ideas. They might do some politically strange things. Claudius chased all the Jews out of Rome during his reign, for instance. That was a political reason, not a religious one. And according to Eusebius, that was done because of the sect of the Christians. But that's another discussion. But Rome generally was eclectic in its thinking. New ideas were accepted. You could go into a Roman city and come up with a new idea. No one seemed to get excited. Another thing that happened, there was a language now that was universal, the Greek language. Not Latin, but the Greek. And it was the business language, and wherever you went, people would speak Greek. And so if you came into a city, as Paul did, Greek speaker, you could communicate to so many different people. And so that helped spread the gospel. So the Greek culture itself also helped the Romans to be more sophisticated, more civilized. And it was easy to travel. A Roman road was called an iter, an iter. interestingly how they were made. They dug a deep hole and put big boulders in first, then smaller and smaller and smaller. And I'm told that some of those roads still exist over there today. And so travel was easy in the Roman Empire, and you could go almost anywhere you needed to go. Because Rome was eclectic in its thinking, they often were found to be tolerant of all kinds of religions. It's interesting that they thought that the Christians were atheists because the Christians did not believe in the Roman gods. They also accused Nero did, of eating, of being cannibalistic because they ate their god. Well, he was not understanding the Lord's Supper, of course. But generally speaking, the Romans tolerated the new religions. There was law, a contribution from the pure Persian Empire. There was not license, not anarchy. It was a time when things were under control. There was law. And on top of all of that, peace, easy travel, universal language, meet everybody from all over the world in one city. Besides all that, there was this idea that no acceptable religion in Rome actually existed. The intellectuals laughed at the Romans who had some kind of thought about a god, and there was no acceptable religion. It's to that city that Paul writes this letter. It's to those people with that eclectic background, many of whom came out of heathenism. It's to this city that Paul writes a treatise of all things about how God justified all people through the Christ. This letter will tell us something about us. It says to me when I read it, Keith, you need to change, and here's your motivation. When I first became a Christian, I heard a preacher say, you cannot earn your way to heaven. He was right. It's a gift from God's grace. But he turned right around in that same sermon and said, but if you don't obey God, you're going to hell. And I thought, that sounds like a contradiction. Well, I don't think he meant to contradict himself. But it helped me to start thinking, why am I working? If God saved me, and I can't earn my salvation, Luke 17:10, I'm still an unprofitable servant, I still need to be declared justified, why am I working? Why am I studying and praying? Well, Peter told me, and I finally found this verse and got satisfied in my thinking at least, because Peter said, grow. Well, there's the command, obey God. In faith and in knowledge, grow in grace and in knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Keith, I want you to study. I want you to become a better person. I want you to get closer to Christ. Why? Well, he tells me in the end of the verse, to him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. So I know now why I do these things. It gives the Father glory, the one who saved me. Jesus said it this way, you're the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it gives light to all that are in the house. Listen to him. So let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and what? Glorify your Father, which is in heaven. Matthew 5, 14 through 16. I need to change, and this letter will tell me that. But it'll also tell me God is good, and God is severe. God is good, and God is just, Romans 11:22. I'll get both sides of the nature of God from studying Romans. It's also the case that I'll learn who the mercy seat is. I'll learn where to meet God in Christ, and he will be elevated for us by the Apostle Paul. It's also the case that in this book, I will learn that the Holy Spirit has a law by which he operates. That helps me understand how he works in my life. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death, Romans 8:3. I'll learn that being a Christian puts me into a state of justification where I'm not condemned. I don't stand in sin anymore. My offering to God doesn't have connected to it in those offerings is a remembrance of sin made every year, Hebrews 10:1-4. But I have learned something else from this letter. Wonderful Church of Christ in the Roman Empire, in the very capital of that empire, Romans 16:16. But just a few years later, in AD 120, they started using holy water to justify. In 157, the idea that you could pay for your repentance. In 394, the Mass. In 588, the extreme anointing of someone about to die to try to get him out of purgatory or into purgatory. In 666, instrumental music was introduced. 709, kissing the Pope's toe brings a blessing. In the year 1000, that's the actual body of Christ on that table. That's the actual blood of Christ on the table. The doctrine of transubstantiation was taught. In 1015, the clergy was told he couldn't get married. In 1190, indulgences. I'll buy my way. I go out this Saturday and commit sin, but I'll pay for it ahead of time. Of course, I'll pay the priest. In 1219, auricular confession. I'll confess my sins to a man, not to God. In 1311, they began to accept sprinkling of adults as baptism. In 1870, the Pope was said never to make a mistake. And in 1953, Peter's bones were found, they said, in the Basilica. Here's a church taught about justification. A Church of Christ. Look at all the apostasy that came out of it. Romans is not an easy book. I tell my students at the Memphis School of Preaching, it's really the hardest book in the New Testament if you don't approach it correctly. You have to understand, the Jews and the Gentiles were at odds with each other. And Paul has to explain to them, neither one of your systems justified anyway. In fact, he'll have the Jews ask, what advantage then do we have? He said, you had the scrolls, Romans 3:1-2. You should have known to read them, which they didn't do. And the scrolls would have told them, there's one coming who's going to change your system. And the Old Testament prophets warned them over and over again, one day the Gentiles coming into the system. Well, the Jews would not accept that. Their prejudice wanted to keep the Gentile out. In fact, in Acts 13:45-46, Paul said to the Jews, since you put Christ from you, we turn to the Gentiles. Listen to Paul again as he states his thesis. I am not ashamed. It doesn't confuse me. We think of the word ashamed as being embarrassed. He was actually saying, I'm not confused about this. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Why, Paul? It is the power of God unto salvation. To everyone who believeth, to the Jew first, he's the one through whom the Christ came, and also to the Greek. And in that message is revealed a righteousness, it says in the Greek, not the, but a righteousness of God from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. I'm hoping that this study of Romans will give us confidence to understand that when someone says to me, are you saved? I can confidently say, I am justified by the blood of Christ. Yes, I am saved. The next time we meet, we will start in chapter 1, hopefully, God willing, that there be a next time. And we'll take a look at the prologue, chapter 1:1-18, and then Paul's beginning of proving his thesis. What is it? It's only in the gospel that a man can be justified. Thank you very much for watching.